Good evening. Take your hymnal, stand, turn to page 445. Page 445, no, not one. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. None else can heal all our souls' diseases. No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. No friend like him is so high and holy. No, not one, no, not one. And yet no friend is so meek and lowly. No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. There's not an hour that he is not near us. No, not one, no, not one. No night so dark but his love can cheer us. No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. Friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. Did ever saint find this friend forsake him? No, not one, no, not one. Or sinner find that he would not take him? No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggle. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. Was there a gift like the Savior given? No, not one, no, not one. Will he refuse us a home in heaven? No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one.
Amen. Well, the rain's over and the sun shines back. Praise the Lord. Speaking of back, everybody over here is back. Everybody over here is forward. Is that what it is? All right. Oh, good to have everybody here tonight. Brother Sam Kimbrough, would you open us a prayer? Amen. Please be seated.
Page 452, My Savior's Love.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. Wonderful is my the blood for mine. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. In pity, angels beheld. And my sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior. Here's love for me. When with the ransom in glory, his face I at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever.
Right on our prayer list, as we mentioned this morning, I want to continue to pray for Brother Dave Howe. He's got some test procedures coming up. Also, Brother Tom. And continue to pray for Miss Margie and Miss Darlene for recovery. And have they said anything, Miss Margie, about when they might do something? Or? Mercy, they don't even... That don't even sound good. God bless your heart. Whew. Somebody told me, Miss Darlene, Pastor Bill Rowan was transferred from Gulf Coast to Health Park, and he's now able to eat some. So you just continue to pray for him. Also, continue to pray for our Vacation Bible School coming up. And Tuesday is the meeting for the workers. Got to put some things together for the program. So we'll be here at 10 a.m. on Tuesday morning. And let's see. Thursday morning, 9:30, is Team B for the outreach. Thursday evening, 5 o'clock at Mel's Diner for the men's night out. Tomorrow night, 5 o'clock at Smokin' Pit, and then afterwards, those that are going to go bowling. And we almost forgot about the 4th of July coming up. We will, that's a Tuesday this week, month. Yeah, this week. Next month, it's Tuesday. Don't worry, we'll get this all figured out someday. Anyway, 4th of July... We'll have a fellowship over next door at 5 p.m. We'll be doing hot dogs and hamburgers. And then after that, those that want to go down to the North Shore Overlook Park, we have an outreach down there each year. There's sign-up sheets in the foyer for this. We hand out John Romans to the people that's waiting for the fireworks to go off. So please join with us. All right, ushers, go ahead and come at this time, please. Tomorrow?
And see if the super glue stuck.
Let's hope so. Or Trivet. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer for our offering. Brother EJ. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Pete. Page 265. Page 265, we have an anchor.
Will your anchor hold in the storms of life when the clouds unfold their wings of strife? When the strong tides lift and the cables strain, will your anchor drift or firm remain? We have an anchor that keeps us whole, steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. It is safely moored till the storm withstand, for 'tis well secured by the Savior's hand. Though the tempest rage and the wild winds blow, not an angry wave shall our bark or flow. We have an anchor that keeps us whole, steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Pass into the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. When our eyes behold through the gathering night the city of gold, our harbor bright, we shall anchor fast by the heavenly shore. With the storms all pass, Lord, that keeps us so steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Pass into the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love.
And page 210. Page 310. My error. Page 310, Whiter Than Snow. Page 310.
Lord Jesus, I long to be perfectly whole. I want thee forever to live in my down every foe. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Whiter than snow, yes, whiter than snow. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Lord Jesus, look down from thy throne in the skies and help me to make a complete sacrifice. I give up myself at whatever I know. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Whiter than snow, yes, whiter than snow. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Lord Jesus, for this I most humbly entreat. I wait, blessed Lord, at thy crucified feet. By faith for my cleansing, I see thy blood flow. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Whiter than snow, yes, whiter than snow. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Lord Jesus, thou seest I patiently wait. Come now and within me a new heart create. To those who have sought thee, thou never saidst no. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Whiter than snow, yes, whiter than snow. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow.
Again, it's good to have Brother Don Strange and Miss Judy with us, and what a blessing they always are. Amen. You and the missus get a chance on July the 4th. If you're not doing nothing, come be with us.
Well, we're in our Tuesday nights of great preaching over
church. Oh, is that started already?
Yes, it has.
Oh, has it?
And
how do you get a schedule on that? Is there something online that tells you who's coming?
If you call over there, they'll give you one. Or if I find out, I'll try to give you a call back.
Do that. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
God bless you. Thank you for coming back tonight. While we've been here, I have read the book of 1 John, 2 John, 3 John every day in the 2 weeks that I've been here. And it's still an amazing book. And who can ever plumb the depths of the Word of God, no matter where you dip your pail, you'll always be able to find new water, something that you haven't seen before. And I've heard the announcements here, and I've heard your outreach programs. You know, you got VBS coming up, and then you have Team B. I'm not sure they go do something. Then Team A probably does it on a different day. And when you go down to the water for the 4th of July, you'll pass out to John and Romans. And one of the things that I have picked up from your announcements is that you are involved in getting the gospel out. And I was reminded of a story about a friend of mine, Don Chitty. Don Chitty was a Marine that they went places they didn't go and did things they didn't do. That's how bad they were. And he got shot, and they thought he was dead, put him in a body bag, and threw his body on a helicopter along with other body bags. And while they're in the air, just having taken off, he moved. And the young man that was back there, he said to the pilot, "This guy moved back here." He said, "Well, they do that sometimes when they die. They have muscles that reflex and release gases and so forth." And he said, "Okay." In just a minute or two, he moved again. He said, "We'll open it up and look." He said, "I'm not opening that." So the pilot came back and he opened it, and sure enough, Don Chitty was not dead. And they switched off to a MASH unit and gave him some blood, saved his life. But for probably 3 months, the people thought he was dead. His wife thought he was dead. And when he came back, he was bad. He was a bad man. Nothing good about him. And his wife would go to church. She had gotten saved, and he'd cuss her out. And they tried to win him to the Lord, and finally he made a profession of faith, and he said, "I knew I got saved when I didn't cuss my wife out." Sad, isn't it? And he went to Tennessee Temple, and from there he went to out west to have a ministry with the Navajo Indians. And the Navajo Indians were sent to a reservation there. They didn't have any water, didn't have any animals on it, but they said you can go there and hunt and fish. There wasn't anything to hunt and fish. And he came to the conclusion that they sent him out there just to die. But they didn't die. And he was there, and he took his wife and his two boys. And the first year, he knocked on doors, and nobody showed up. He preached Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night to his wife and two kids. After a year, he said to his wife, "Well, we're going to go home." And she said, "Well, I thought God called you out here." And he said, when he tells this story, he said, "Don't you hate women that have a spiritual mind like that? Well, you're going to go home. Didn't God call you out here?" And so he didn't go home again. Well, another year went by, and he preached to his wife, to his kids, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. Nobody got saved. Nobody came. So after the second year, he said to his wife, "We're going to go home." She said, "Well, we're going to drive two cars." He said, "Why are we going to drive two cars?" She said, "Because God's going to kill you." Well, he didn't go again. So after year number three, nobody, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, he preached to his wife and his two kids, and he said, "We're going to go home now." So he's putting the key in the door to lock it, and here's what she said. "Don, why don't you quit your quitting?" Now, I just like that. Quit your quitting. And so he didn't leave again, and I think it was like the next week or so, one Wednesday night, 89 Indians walked in his place. He said, "I preached everything I knew on salvation, gave the invitation, and nobody moved." And he said, "Now, folks, the way we do it at church is when the service is over, you're free to leave." And a teenage boy who's with him to this day, he said, "Preacher, we're afraid to leave. We're afraid we'll go to hell." So he said, "We'll have a seat again." So he got his wife in, let her speak to the ladies. He spoke to the men. At about midnight on that Wednesday night, 89 Indians called on the Lord Jesus Christ to be saved. They're very matriarchal, and the grandmother of that group of people, she said, "Well, preacher, what do we do next?" He said, "Well, tomorrow I'll go into the city, and I'll buy a horse trough, and we'll baptize you on Sunday." She said, "Well, preacher, what about that mud hole out there? Would that work? It's got water in it." He said, "Well, yeah, that would work." They said, "Well, let's do that." It turned the cars so that the lights of the cars went over that mud hole. He baptized all 89 of those Indians. That's a powerful story. That's one of those God stories. Now, I told you that. I would hope this and like this. All the effort that you've given out the gospel, all those tracts that you've passed out, every time you've gone down to the fair, down to the flea market, or down to the wherever, is that one day God would just open up the floodgates at Grace Baptist and people come in and getting saved. You've been faithful. Keep on being faithful. The Lord's coming soon. In the book of 1 John, if you would, probably doesn't surprise you. We have been in there for a little bit. And tonight, in chapter 3, and picking it at verse 19. "And hereby we know that we are of the truth and shall assure our hearts before him." Remember I told you the first time we spoke on this from the book of 1 John, how many times the word know is mentioned, K-N-O-W. Know, known, knoweth, knoweth. It is a number of times. God wants us to know some things. And God wants us to know that we're saved. God wants us to know him. And verse 20 says, "And hereby we know that we are of the truth and shall assure our hearts before him. For if our heart condemn us, God is greater than our heart and knoweth all things. Beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence toward God. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And this is his commandment, that we should believe on the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us commandment." And then if you would, in chapter 5 and verse 14, this follows the great section on God has given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. And then he said, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. But verse 14 says, and this is the confidence that we have in him. The confidence, someone said, is like a word that you're uninhibited to speak. You're not ashamed to speak. You feel free to speak. Feel free to speak your mind. And he said, this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he hear us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of him. May it please the great God of heaven that formed all things to stamp his divine approval upon the reading, hearing, heeding, and preaching of his forever settled in heaven word of God. Before I ask you to pray with me, would I be able to give you three quick facts about God? For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for this time. Thank you for Grace Baptist, and Lord, for Pastor DeVore and Miss Debbie and the folks here at Grace. Would you be gracious to Grace? And I pray you keep your hand on Brother DeVore. Lord, he told me a while ago he wouldn't be able to get an MRI on his neck and so forth till in the middle of July. Would you touch him? Lord, you just told us to ask. So I'm asking you, Lord, will you just touch Brother Forrest DeVore and raise him up, but touch this ministry. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, there are people who think that prayer doesn't work at all. And yet there's an interesting prayer that when Abraham was looking for a bride for his son Isaac, and he sent his servant Eliezer, and he said, I want you to go back, and told him where to go. And he said, I want you to find a bride for my son Isaac. And he said, well, what if he won't come? Then he said, well, then you'll be released from this oath. And so he goes, takes some of the servants and a bunch of camels, and they go over to that area where Abraham was from. And the man stopped and he prayed, Lord, I'm looking for a bride for Isaac, and I need your help. And dear Lord, and this is what I prayed. He said, I'm going to ask some young lady who comes out for a drink of water. And if she's the one, would you let her not only give me a drink of water, but would you let her say, I will water all your camels? What a prayer. And do you know camels do have multiple stomachs, and they can drink quite a bit. So this gal comes out, and she's a pretty gal. And he said, could I have a drink? And so she lets down her water pot, and she says, well, I'll just water your camels too. And the man thanked God for answering his prayer. Now, you know, there are a number of places in the Bible where people, like Hannah, the priest thought she was drunk because she was such of a burdened soul that she's just moving her mouth, but nothing's coming out, and she's asking God for a son. Lord, if you'll give me a son, I'll loan him back to you forever. And Samuel was the answer to that prayer. And there are a number of places in the Bible where God had heard and answered prayer. Now, in the text of Scripture that I read to you, he is saying that, I want you to know some things, and God does want us to know. And he said, I don't want your heart to condemn you. If your heart condemns you, God's greater than our heart. If your heart condemns you not, does your heart know anything against you? And sometimes our heart does know some things against us. The condemn is sort of like a word in court. Somebody is condemned. They might say guilty. And, you know, the Lord has already paid for our sins. And if you trust him, you're no longer under condemnation. In the book of Romans chapter 8, it's one of the great chapters in the book of Romans. In the latter verses, he asks a series of questions, and then he answers them. And in Romans 8 verse 31, he says, if God be for us, who can be against us? God is for us and not against us. We have three enemies, the flesh, the world, and the devil. And God is for us. And he asked that question. In Romans 8, 32, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? You know, if God will give you his son, he didn't spare his son, and he gave him for you, don't you think he'd give you other things too? Arguing from the greater to the lesser. And he said in Romans 8:33, who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. So if God justifies us, who can condemn us or charge us? Romans 8:34, you see this verse after verse. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. All in one verse, we have Jesus died, Jesus risen, Jesus ascended, because he's at the right hand of God, and Jesus is interceding for us in one verse. Then he said in verse 35, Romans 8:35, who shall separate us from the love of God, the love of Christ? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? And then he lists things like tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, or sword. None of those things can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. One of the reasons that God has given to us eternal life, because the Bible says in the book of Romans, or rather in the book of 1 John, that God sent his son. If you look in verse 8 of chapter 4, verse 9, in this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten son into the world that we might live through him. That we might live through him. And then verse 10, herein is love, not that we love God. If you want to talk about what love is, it's not, oh, how I love Jesus. It's, oh, how Jesus loves us. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. He said that in this was manifested the love of God towards us, because God sent his only begotten son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we love God, but they loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins. And God has given us, because he wants us to live, and he has taken care of our sin problem. God has given to us eternal life. And it's free. It's a gift from God. But it's found in Jesus. And this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. So he is saying, look, I want you to know that you're saved. I want you to know that. And then he's telling us in this same passage of Scripture, I want you to know that God does answer prayer. He answers prayer because he said, look, I want you to ask. And if you ask, you'll receive. Dr. John R. Rice, evangelist who founded the Sword of the Lord, he wrote a book called Prayer, Asking and Receiving. I read that book years ago. It's a good book. Prayer, he said, prayer is not just asking. Prayer is asking and receiving. You ask for a reason, because you want something. And how many times Jesus mentioned ask? He said, ask and ye shall find. Ask and ye shall receive. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth, and that seeketh, finds it and knocks, it'll be open to them. And if your father, if you were to ask your father for a fish, would he give you a stone or a scorpion? If you know, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more does your heavenly father know how to give good things to them that ask him? I was listening to a sermon the other night by David Gibbs. David Gibbs is the lawyer with the Christian Law Association. He's a great storyteller. But he said, God has laid out something. He just wants you to ask. Ask him. And if you don't ask him, it means you don't want God to do anything for you. He wants us to ask him. In the text that I read to you here, he said in verse 22, whatsoever we ask, we receive of him. You know, it sounds like it's pretty open. How many of you remember a story that was on TV? This is so secular and so carnal. How many of you remember a program called The Millionaire? The Millionaire was this very wealthy man would seek out somebody, and he would go give them $1 million, put it in their account. Now, there was a little caveat to it. They could not tell anybody where it came from. Now, that would raise a few eyebrows. Here's a guy that doesn't have anything. All of a sudden, now he's able to go buy whatever he wants, do whatever he wants, but they could not tell where it came from. What if somebody called you tonight and said, I just put $1 million in your bank account, and it's yours. You can do what you want to with it. And they hang up. First of all, if you believed it, would that be a little exciting? And so then a couple days goes, you tell your wife, and a couple days goes by, and she said, you know, you ought to go down to the bank and get some of that $1 million and buy some things that we need here. And while you're there, get enough to pay off our credit cards and maybe pay off the car and probably even pay off our house. And then maybe there'll be a little more left over. You could give something to missions and give something to your church. And what if you said, well, I'm not sure I believe that. And so you don't go down and get it. And then you die never having gone and gotten any of the thing that was put in your account. And if somebody found out about that, they'd think, that's pretty dumb, isn't it? Did you have access to all of that and you don't do anything about it? Well, probably not any dumber than the Lord said, you want something? Ask. And you shall receive. God just wants us to ask Him. You have not because you ask not. When I got saved at the age of 19 in the United States Navy, and started going to a little country church, Indian Creek Independent Baptist Church, and there was two or three other guys that got saved as well around that time. Miss Judy stopped by in Mount Vernon, Illinois, when we were coming back from our trip, and I had called the guy who led me to the Lord. His name was Brad Dye, and I said, how far are you from Mount Vernon? He said, I'm about 30 miles. And I said, is there some place in Mount Vernon we could meet and have dinner? And it was, and we did. And it was good to see him after a number of years. But when we first got saved, some of us guys, we would challenge each other about memorizing scripture verses. And who could remember? Now, that may not be the best motive to see who could do it the quickest. But the first one that I did, I still remember it. John 16:24. Hitherto have ye asked nothing in my name. Ask and ye shall receive, that your joy may be full. Jesus mentioned a number of times, ask. Just ask. Now, the idea is that you don't ask and then stop. Well, I asked and nothing happened. The idea is that you ask and you keep on asking. You keep on asking till you get that. But the point is that you ask. There are a number of things in the Bible that you and I would like that all we have to do is ask. How would you like for God to come to you and say, what would you like? I'll give you whatever you want. You'd say, well, this can't be real. This can't be true. But God did that to Solomon. And he said, what would you like to have? God appeared to him. You see, this is one of the things that bugs us about Solomon. At the end of his life, he let women turn his heart away from God. And God appeared to him twice and made him the wisest man who ever lived. And but you have to understand that best of men is still men at their best. And all men have feet of clay. And he said, ask what you'd like for me to do for you. And at that moment, he was obviously a pretty spiritual-minded man. And he said, well, you helped my dad, so forth and so on. And he said, now I'm the leader. And he said, would you give me an understanding heart, that I might be able to lead your people in such a way that it would be honoring to you? Now, he did not say, I want the death of all my enemies. I want to be wealthy, and I want to be this and this and this. And David Gibbs said that God told him, I'm going to give you everything you didn't ask for because you asked for the right thing. And because he had asked for understanding and wisdom to be wise, He said, so I'm going to give you. I'm going to give you wisdom. Now, in James chapter 1 and verse 5, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. When David Gibbs was talking about ask, he said that knowledge is an accumulation of facts. But wisdom is knowing what to do and when to do it. There are a lot of people that have accumulated a lot of facts, but they don't know what to do and when to do it. And God gives wisdom on what to do and when to do it. And he said, if any man lack wisdom. So if you lack, and I lack, you ask. And when you ask, you can expect to receive. And God gives you liberally and upbraideth not. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. God just wants us to ask him. And you can ask him for wisdom. And you could ask him for just good things. The Bible says in Matthew 7, 9 through 11, or what man is there of you whom if his son asks bread, will he give him a stone? If he asks a fish, will he give him a serpent? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Father, which is in heaven, give good things to them that ask him? What's the last thing that any of us ask God for? We ought to ask God for good things. Not, he said, you know, sometimes you don't get it because you ask amiss to heap it upon yourself and your own lusts. Wouldn't it be a wonderful thing if we asked God if he'd fill up this place? That all those gospel tracts in John and Romans that you all have passed out over the years would come to fruition and some people would come in and have a hungry heart for God. And they want what you have. And you're asking God for those people. And Jesus, numbers of times, he said, ask. Just ask. So what are you asking God for? What do you want God to do for you? Jesus said, therefore, said he unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. If you have need for VBS workers, ask. If you have need for Sunday school teachers, ask. If you have need for people to come and stuff this and stuff that and fix this and fix that, if you have need of singers or whomever, just ask. You have not because you ask not. And God wants us to ask. You ever ask God to send out a missionary from your church? I sometimes would pray when I was pastoring over Winkle Road that the Lord would call some of our young people to mission field. Now, sometimes when you pray that way, God may send your best people. That's what happened at the church in Antioch. They had those five teachers there, two of whom were Paul and Barnabas, and God called those two. And if God calls those two, he'll replace those with other good ones. So you don't have to worry about losing your workers. Just pray for the ones that you need. God just wants us to pray. God wants us to ask. You know, call unto me, God said, and I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. You know, if you want salvation, you ask for that. You remember the man, two guys went up to the temple. One was a Pharisee, the other one was a publican. The Pharisee said, Lord, I'm glad I'm not like other men. I'm glad I'm not like that guy. I do this, 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 and this. God wasn't impressed. The other guy, he just smote upon his breast and he said, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. It's like, God, sinner, mercy. And Jesus said, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. God just wants us to ask. Ask and keep on asking. I want to tell you a story. I came across this, I was in a bookstore one day, and came across a little book called 70 Years of Miracles.
Wow.
For a preacher, that interested me. And, you know, this helped me one day. I was reading in the Gospel of John, chapter 10. John, speaking of John the Baptist, did no miracle. He never did a miracle. But all things he said of this man, everything that John the Baptist said about Jesus was the truth. That encouraged me because I've never done a miracle either. I wish I could do miracles. I would touch Brother DeVore right now. I've had people that have gone in our church who've gone in and had major kind of surgery. If I could have done a miracle, I would have done it for them. John did no miracle, but he told the truth about Jesus. And I told our people, I don't have to do a miracle. I just have to tell you the truth about Jesus. And I always tried to tell them the truth about Jesus. Sometimes I had other people to help me to do that. But I want to tell the truth about Jesus as it is recorded in the Bible. Well, in that little book, 70 Years of Miracles, there was a story. It's become known as the flask, F-L-A-S-K story. A flask is a little, it's a chemistry object. It has a little surface like this on the bottom, and then it has a neck. And they would use this with the experiments and so forth. And there was a professor, supposedly he said he believed in God, but he didn't believe in the God of the Bible. If there was a God, he wasn't interested in people now, and he certainly didn't answer prayers. And so this chemistry professor, a lot of people had to take the course because of their major, and then there were some people who took it because they liked Dr. Lee, and he was a learned kind of man. But every year around Thanksgiving, he interrupted his chemistry lessons, and he would give them little lectures on miracles, that he poo-pooed the idea that there are no such thing as miracles, and he poo-pooed the idea of prayers and getting their answers. And here's what he would do. He would pick up He would pick up something. This is a flask. He said, now, after he gave these lectures on prayers, that God doesn't hear prayers and God's not interested in prayers, and he said, if you still believe in prayer, I'm going to hold this flask out, and I'm going to let you pray that when I drop it, it won't break. And he'd hold it out and said, any takers? Well, he had intimidated those young college students. Nobody would raise their hand. And he thought, man, he's still the king. One day, a young Christian guy came and he said to one of his friends, a Christian friend, he said, I want you to pray with me. God's laid it on my heart to accept Dr. Lee's challenge. And I'd like for you to agree to pray with me and stand with me. He said, I will. So they signed up for Dr. Lee's chemistry class, and they came to Thanksgiving, and he gave his lectures. And he came to the flask, and he said, now, if you still believe in prayer, I'm going to hold the flask out and let you pray, and that God won't break it, and we'll see what happens. But he said, I just want you to know, God's not going to answer that. The flask, when I drop it, it is going to break. Now, you can call your mama, you can call your grandma, you can call your preacher, you can call whoever you want to. But I just want you to know that when I drop the flask, it is going to break. Anybody want to pray? And this young man stood up, stepped in the aisle, and he said, I do, sir. And the professor looked, oh, I see we have a taker. Now, son, I just want you to know, when I drop the flask, it's going to break. You still want to pray? He said, I do. He said, now, class, let's get real reverent for this young man and give him an opportunity to pray that the flask won't break when I drop it, but it's going to break. And so that young man, he stood up and he said, God, I know that you hear me. Please honor the name of Jesus, your son, and honor me, your servant. Please don't let that flask break. Amen. And the professor stood there with that flask like this. You could imagine it sucked all the air out of that room. And all of a sudden, he opened his hand, and that flask fell in an arc.
It fell in toward his leg, rolled off his shoe onto the floor, and did not break. There were no windows open. There were no fans moving. And I'm telling you, when that happened, the people whistled, clapped, and cheered. But that was the last lecture that professor ever gave on the miracles and the prayer again. You know, God just wants us to ask. Just ask. You may ought to ask the Lord tonight for something that you need. Just ask. And then don't go home tonight and say, well, I asked him in church and he didn't do it, so I'm going to quit. No, keep on asking. Every time he said ask, he almost said it, followed up with you shall receive. He said, this is the confidence that if we ask anything according to his will, we know that he hears us. And if he hears us, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of him. God wants us to learn to ask and receive. So what do you need? What would you ask God for if he said, just ask me, just ask me? Let's bow our heads, stand to our feet. Simple, isn't it? Ask. Ask. Your Father, right now, people, I think, are probably thinking of some things they'd like to ask you for. Lord, certainly this takes into the account of you can't ask God for sin things and ask him to bless that. But if it's right things, they can ask. And may they receive. With their heads bowed and their eyes closed. Brother Austin, tonight was just going to let the young lady play. And while she's playing, if you've got something on your heart and mind that you'd just like to ask God for, would you just come up to the altar and do it? Ask him. Just come up and ask him. That's right. God bless you, sir. You want...